audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, it is LoveLine. I'm Dr. Drew. The phone number here, 1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine, tonight's guest, Linkin Park. Mike and Rob, welcome.
Hi, Drew.
A band we really like here. I apologize for my partner's absence. He will be here momentarily, I guarantee it.
Awesome.
Things have changed since last time we saw you, haven't they? I mean, given the fact that, I mean, we have a lot of big bands that come in here once in a while, and, you know, you get a decent crowd, but you guys had like a riot out there. It's pretty nice.
Yeah, it's cool. We're trying not to be any different, but definitely there's a lot of kids, you know, when we get out to do these events and stuff. I definitely see a lot of kids out there.
New CD today?
Yes, very exciting.
Were you at a store or anything today?
We went to Tower on Sunset.
Were they following you?
It was weird because we actually, somebody thought it up like last week and said, hey, let's do this, you know, let's just go over to Tower and see if we can do a little release thing, you know, a little party or something. And it kind of just didn't work. Like everybody's, you know, they were worried about the scheduling and advertising it. So we didn't advertise it. People told a couple of people, but
a billion people showed up.
Yeah, it was pretty. Yeah. It was good. Well, I mean, it wasn't like blocking traffic, but it was like, you know, for not
saying
anything.
We just get the tail of the comet here, and there's still traffic being blocked in the street outside this studio.
Yeah, it was mostly our fan club. We listed it to them, and a lot of them showed up.
I see. And it comes out today. It's the second CD, Reanimation.
Yeah.
Are we going to hear from it tonight?
Yeah.
Are these first?
We actually. Well, what's going on with it is kind of like we are. We're not telling anybody about any singles or anything or focusing on any tracks. I mean, Points of Authority is kind of the first one that we got has been played on stations because we have a video that goes along with it. And really the main reason why that one had a video is just because our DJ, Mr. Han, really wanted to do a video to it. It's like a robotic song. That's kind of been the theme visually of the album, because it is like a digital version of the original, so everything's like a robotic version of the original. He did a video that's completely CGI. We aren't even in it.
Wow.
I mean, it's got our scans of our faces, and that's about it.
Oh, interesting.
And it's really action-packed and violent.
Oh, nice.
and so Points of Authority is pretty much the first one that I think people will hear.
And you guys are working on yet a third right now, right?
Yeah, we're in the studio.
All right. Linkin Park, Rob and Mike, let's take some calls. How about that? You ready?
Yeah.
All right, hold on here. Find a good one. This is Angel, who is 22. We've learned on this show to be careful with women named Angel.
Hello.
Hi, Angel. What's going on?
Not much. How are you guys?
Awesome.
Hello.
Hi.
Linkin Park is a guest. Oh, and Adam Carolla is yet another guest. Shocking.
Hey, unacceptable.
We're talking to Angel, who's 22. They're not bad. I know. Adam had to film 3 man shows today, right?
Yes.
Oh, I mean, it's amazing that you even came in tonight. It's because of you guys he's even here.
Thank you, Adam.
Thank you, Linkin Park.
Sorry, Adam.
That's all right. We'll get going. No problem.
I think Angel was hoping that she could get away without any Adam on this call. She's like, thank God.
No.
You stinking whore.
All right, Angel, what's going on?
No, you guys are completely wrong. Actually, I need Adam's advice.
Great. Right. Here I am. An F buddy.
5 words in, she's using the F word. Are we going to go back to her?
No, no.
Yeah, just won't let us.
Punish her a little bit. You want to switch, Drew?
No.
Okay.
I know you can't stand it.
I don't have enough
it.
Energy to fight.
Cut her off for good, please.
I don't like sitting in. I don't like sitting in the bitch seat, Drew.
It's your punishment.
Right.
You could have been here on time. This is Henry, who's 18.
Hello.
Hey, Henry. What's going on?
Hey, pretty good.
What's up, Henry?
See what happens, Drew, when you take over Captain Kirk's seat.
It's not my fault that the callers suck.
What's up?
What's up, Henry?
What's going on?
Talk to us, bro.
Yeah, I was just wondering, I've been taking ecstasy for the last, like, 3 months now.
Great.
And, I've just been noticed a lot lately. I'm just, like, limp most of the time now.
Terrific.
And I was wondering, like, is that, like, normal? Is it, like, a side effect or something, or is it just...
Yeah, it's a side effect that you can get depressed, you can have,
Well, me and my buddies, like, we're doing a lot, and, like, I haven't noticed that I get depressed, like, afterwards, and a lot of people do.
Well, how long have you been doing it?
3 months, he said.
3 months?
Six months.
How, every day?
No, not at all. Just, like, I don't know, about, like, 30 times the last 3 months.
Can that screw with your penis, Drew?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Maybe he's depressed because his penis doesn't work.
Well, it all kind of goes
not
together.
Like all the time, I mean.
Henry, you're using a drug right that is known to be a neurotoxin. It's well established. It damages part of the brain. And part of your central nervous system function is your schwanz, your penis.
That's all of it, right?
Well, that's where it all gets focused.
Wait, what'd you say?
All right, hang up on him. Stop doing drugs. But listen, Drew, your penis is sort of the yardstick that you measure your health by, isn't it? I mean, the first thing that goes south is your penis.
That's
you're doing too many drugs. You're screwing up. You have problems. It all goes to the penis,
well,
right?
When you're damaging your body, yes, it makes it difficult for you to have sexual functioning.
Yeah, but why is that the first part that goes? I mean, bands can go on tours, no problem. People can do an hour and a half stand-up gigs, no problem. People can carry on relationships and jobs, no problem. But yet the penis seems so easily affected.
There's no override for the penis. You can't will your penis to do anything.
It's
the most honest.
I got my penis to take out the garbage like 3 days ago.
That's pretty good.
I did. I yelled at it. We got a big blowout
really,
in the living room.
It's the most honest reflection of what's going on with your physical state.
Hold on. You get it, Drew? Blowout?
I missed that.
All right.
Good.
Yeah. All right. What the hell is going on with these calls? Drew, do you see what happens when you sit in the command module?
You really want to move over here, don't you?
Yeah. All right. You ready? Yeah. We'll do it.
You guys talk.
Wait a minute. Okay, Drew smacked the mic. Let's do it. I was going to say we could have heard a Linkin Park song or something while we did the switch, but I'm taking the mic with me.
No.
All right, ready, Drew?
Yeah.
I'm
going
to hand the mic off to you, but you got to talk. And talk.
Thanks for farting.
This
over
is
here.
Really funny.
I didn't fart over there.
It's too bad what's people can't
smell?
See
you,
this.
You smell for the first time.
Thank you.
Is it your breath?
What I've been
that?
Drinking beer.
Oh,
this
my
is
God.
A man show. It's a man show. Come
oh
on.
Oh, my God. Do you smell that?
Oh, Drew.
Not yet.
You're like McGruff, the crime dog. Guy drinks a half a beer, and it's a federal offense with you.
Well, where do you keep your wallet?
Up my ass. All right. You guys cool?
Cool.
You all right? I'm sorry for the confusion, but we're back now. That's the point. All right. What do you want to do here, Drew? Want to speak to Sarah?
Yeah.
Sarah's 18. Sarah?
Hello.
What's up?
Hi. How are you?
Good.
Adam, Dr. Linkin Park, you're all great. I just calling around 3 years ago. Hello?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, around 3 years ago, I went out with this guy for like 3 months, and he was like really emotionally abusive. And a little later, I developed like an eating disorder, like bulimia, and then like it stopped, and then I had like anorexia later. And the weird thing was that, like, he wouldn't tell me that I was stupid or I was, like, he would tell me that I was, like, fat the other way around. He would tell me, like...
Drew, hold on. Let's switch seats again. This isn't working out.
He would tell me I'm, like, stupid and there was nothing to me. And the only reason why, like why he was with me was because of my looks. And, like, in high school was hell for me. Like, girl, I had no friends who were girls. All my friends were guys. All these girls would, like, put me down and tell me that I should cut my hair and that I was, like, too ugly and that, you know, there's, like, guys would talk to me.
All right, all right. You had a rough life. We get it. But what's the question?
My question is, like, now, like, I stopped, like, eating again, and it's, like, off and on, off and on.
All right, so you need, the eating disorders are always chronic and always come and go, and it needs to be treated.
And... what am I supposed to do? Like, I went to, like, a ton of psychiatrists, and they don't, like, they're, like, they seem so stupid to me. All they do is sit there and nod, and I think half the time they fall asleep, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, the fact that you feel that way about somebody who's trying to help you says a lot, too. So why don't you go back on your own, because you want to go back and get some help and open yourself up.
No, I do, and every time I go, I've been to, like, many of them. Like,
well, why don't you stick with one and stay there for a long time?
Never leave.
I stayed with one, like, for 4 months, and
that is not
the
even,
longest one ever.
That isn't the beginning of what you need. You need a long-term relationship with someone.
We're talking hundreds of years, maybe thousands.
But there's something disrupted in your ability to trust people and the way you sort of project a lot of hostility. And I don't know if your dad abused you or left you or what the deal is.
Like, my dad's around. My dad's, like, so, like, wonderful.
Well,
like,
then mom is the pain here. Mom.
No, my mom, they're both really good parents. Like, that's why, like, every time I listen to the show, I'm like, but I have normal parents, you
all
know?
All right. Well, then stop acting like an idiot. I mean, you have normal parents, right?
Yeah, so why?
All right, so calm down. You should be more normal. You have no excuse. Go to the shrink. Focus on your eating disorder.
Get some help.
They get on my nerves. They don't, like, they don't listen. Like, I tell them one thing, and they're like, really? And then they just, like, get on. I just want, I hate them. Like, I don't like
All right, well, what's your plan? What do you want to do? You don't want to go to the shrink. You don't want to work on your eating disorder. What's the plan?
I can work. It's more like if I don't do it on my own, it's more has to do with me. If I don't do it on my own and I don't sit down, like, sit put, like, nothing works.
What is your plan?
I've given up by now. It's like, now it's like I go with the flow. Like,
all right, so you have no plan, you've given up, and you're not taking our advice. So what are we going to do?
Is there anything else?
Hey, you can take our advice.
What do you want us to do? Send over Kazoo from the Flintstones. You can talk to a magic Martian who's going to magically get away, take away all your problems. What do you want to do? You got to do some work.
I've done, like, so much. It's, like, ridiculous. And
okay, well, listen, we're going to get off the phone with you because you don't want to do anything.
No, I'm going to, like, do it. Like, I have no choice. Not.
All right, good. Then do it.
Then go start going to some groups, maybe.
But
some
there's this other thing I wanted to ask you.
No. No.
It's really important.
No, it's not bigger than this one. How about you do the group thing?
Groups would be very helpful for you.
So listen, don't call the show, have us give you advice, and then talk us out of it.
I think it has to do more with, like, my friendships. Like, I have, like, no friends who are girls. Like, they all hate me. They all think
I'm,
like,
stop being a bitch.
There's a reason for that.
There's a reason
for that, and that's exactly why a group might be very helpful to sort of examine how those relationships play out and see if you can get something in a more sort of structured, supervised, contained environment. You really look at these things carefully.
All right. Jesus Christ. Listen, people, if you don't have any friends, it's because you're a pain in the ass. I'm tired of hearing everyone's sob stories. I know I've only been here for 8 minutes, but I'm having an ass full of all you kids tonight. Don't argue with us. There's a reason you're where you're at. That reason is you. Now, if you do what you want to do, there's just going to be more crap in your life.
It's going to be more you. That's
you got to start listening to other people. It's look at it this way. It's if you're, like, wandering through the wilderness and you don't know where you are and you just keep walking in circles and someone's got to come around and give you a map.
It's worse yet. You're blind.
Like, I'm
going to
start talking
deaf.
About Jesus in a second, yeah, doesn't it?
A little bit.
The map is
the shepherd will show you through.
But Adam, when there was only one pair of footsteps, what happened?
The Bible is your map, my son.
Son, that is when I carried you.
That's right. Look. Whatever you're doing, it ain't working. So stop listening to yourself and start listening to Drew. That's what I'm saying.
I want you to know, Adam, this microphone stinks.
I had a beer and a... What'd I say I had? Half a beer. I had a beer and a half a beer.
Okay.
Please, Drew. Right. We did our last man show tonight. There were tears shed. There was beer spilled. It was an emotional evening.
I bet.
Yeah, I had to get the hell out of here and get here. I can't not drink beer. It's a man show. Michelle?
Yes.
You're 16?
Yes.
What's up?
Well, I had sex like 2 weeks ago, and I'm supposed to get my period like at the end of this month, beginning of next month, you know? And I'm not sure if the guy came in me or not, and what are the chances if he did that would have got me pregnant since it was like 2 weeks ago?
So it's too late to take the morning after pill, right?
Yeah.
Did you think about doing that?
No, I wasn't really thinking.
Do you know what that is, the morning after pill?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a birth control pill you can take after you have sex. It works the same way as the one that you take before you have sex.
Who was the guy?
Just this guy. Well, because I was at a party and I was kind of drunk and it just kind of happened.
Well, why don't you take a pregnancy test?
That's
the only way you're going to find out whether or not you're pregnant. Theorizing about the probabilities is useless. Find out.
But if it was 2 weeks ago and you're supposed to start your period when?
Like really soon, the end of this month, beginning of next month.
That's a bad time.
Yeah, it's not a good time to have somebody's penis inside you.
Probably the worst time.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's time to get a pregnancy test.
Drew, is there ever a good time for a young lady to have someone's penis inside them?
Well, I know, but it's, you know.
No, okay. That's a bad time, though, because you're supposed to ovulate like halfway between periods, right, Drew?
Right, Adam.
So.
Roughly.
That was about 2 weeks ago, and you're due to start your period. That was right in the danger zone.
That sucks.
Yeah. All right, baby. You got to get a pregnancy
test. She's real realistic about this, isn't she?
Well, she knows it sucks.
Well, because I know I shouldn't have
There's no front here. It's just like, you know, yeah, that's what happened. It sucks.
Yeah, Michelle, you got to start taking charge, right?
Well, I know, but like, I don't know. I was a little not there at all, and
Right, but now you're here, right?
Yeah.
And you may be pregnant.
Were you raped?
Was I what?
Raped?
No.
Okay. So you got to take a pregnancy test, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but sure I will. Not. Yeah, uh-huh. Mm, sure, no, Adam, no, Mr. No. Smart.
With
guy.
Everybody tonight.
Everybody.
What do you want Drew to do?
No, I've come taken over there. I've, what? Like, taken pregnancy tests before and everything. It's like...
Well, as long as you took one and it was negative, that's fine. How many years ago was that?
No, it was
You can
like,
still use that same one.
Well, I'm dying to hear what her point's going to be.
I don't have a point, really.
You've taken pregnancy tests before and...
No, I'm just saying I've taken one before, so it's like no big deal. I can go and get one.
Well, okay, there you go.
But it would work even though... It's
been 2 weeks.
Okay.
All right. Is that how long it takes? Mm-hmm. 2 weeks?
Well, it's something
days?
A little faster, but 2 weeks, fine.
All right, Michelle.
All right, thank you.
All right, you got to be more careful next time, right?
Morning after, we'll keep that in your closet, in your medicine cabinet.
Okay.
It reduces pregnancy same way as the pill you take before you have sex. It's just not quite as effective.
Oops, I screwed something up. Yeah, but listen, you don't have to... I don't even keep it in your medicine cabinet. Keep it in your cheek. Like, you know when they captured a lot of the war criminals, the Nazi war criminals,
right,
that the cyanide capsules, right, during the Nuremberg trials, they just killed themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, we couldn't have figured that one out. We couldn't. Where's the cyanide capsules, by the way, Drew? I'd like to bring
anymore?
Those back.
They were used up mostly at Jonestown.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Is that what they used?
Mm-hmm.
I told Drew that he needs to keep a cyanide capsule in his teeth for when his daughter gets open. Sorry, a little Freudian slip. Gets older. And Drew swings open the door one evening, and she's there with a young lad, probably performing something that he's been talking about on the show. He just chomped down on it at that point.
Finished himself off, yeah.
Are you thinking about that?
Oh, yeah.
All right. You want to hear a Linkin Park song?
Well, there's a call from a Linkin Park fan. You want to take that first and then take the song?
All right. We'll do that.
These can be very dangerous.
I know. Believe me, I know.
Very
Not
good.
Just for Linkin Park, but for every band we've ever had in here. Jessica?
Hi.
You're 21?
Hey, I am.
What's up?
Hey, I love you guys. Linkin Park, you rock so hard, it's not even funny. And
thank
Adam, you
rule.
Thanks. Lots of Linkin Park fans outside tonight, by the way.
Did you hear us talking about that?
They're like the best new young band in the world.
Yeah, they are.
Next to maybe the White Stripes, you know.
Well, thanks.
They're great.
Is that it?
Yeah, no, I want to ask a question.
All right, go.
Okay, I don't consider myself a lesbian, but the only way I can get to sleep is if I fantasize about being a woman. Just the only way I can get to sleep at night.
You mean so you can masturbate?
No, I don't. I don't. That's just it. I just fall asleep.
It's just how you it's how you soothe yourself.
In a way, I guess.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
you're thinking about having sex with a woman?
Yes, really intimate. Even though in real life I would never do that, but at night is like when I can fall asleep.
It's her self-soothing technique.
But
Adam thinks about blowing guys when he's lying there in bed.
Yeah, that's my that's what I do. Like some guys have they count sheep. I count penises in my ass. A one, a two, a three.
Oh, I have another question.
Three.
When are you guys going to put out Best of Loveline tapes? I'm wondering that.
Ooh.
Like a Best of Loveline, like a CD thing, listen to on the radio?
Another.
Well, when Drew goes on vacation again, you can hear some Best of Loveline. Yeah, it's a good idea.
I
it
mean,
sounds
hell.
Ambitious, though, and it's a little over our heads.
Oh, be brilliant.
Yeah, here's the main problem with this show. No one involved with the show is a particular fan of the show. The people that listen to the show like the show, but we're not motivated enough to actually record our things and put it on a CD.
Be a huge
well, be fair, amongst all the people that are involved with the show, you and I probably like it the best.
I think we may like it. Well, we tolerate it. Other people don't like it who are involved with this show. They look at it as a nuisance in the middle of the night. Jessica?
Yes?
And you never masturbate to these women, though.
No, never.
Why not? You're in bed, it's dark, you're fantasizing?
I don't actually need to masturbate.
But it's sort of a self-soothing thing. It's the way she, you know, thinks about intimate things.
Do you ever masturbate?
No, never have the urge to.
They never have?
No, sir.
Have you been with a guy?
Once.
Just one time?
Yeah, and he thought that I got pregnant, he broke up with me, so I broke up with him, and then it turns out I wasn't pregnant, and he tried to backpedal, and it was like over.
Well, hold on. Let me just correct something here. After someone breaks up with you...
You can't break up with
them. You can't break. It's like when you get fired, you can't quit.
No, I broke up with him.
I know, but he broke up with you first.
No, he tried... Oh, what I mean is he tried to get together with me. He found I wasn't pregnant.
I see.
He was like, oh, honey, I'm like, no, because you thought I was, and you freaked out. And it's like, what kind of man are you?
Jessica, you're fine. Relax. You're going to be great. Don't worry.
There's nothing wrong with
you? Nothing wrong with anything. You're fine.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Linkin Park, you guys are great.
Thank you.
And she likes Linkin Park.
Yeah, so she can't be all bad. Let's hear something from Linkin Park. Anderson, come on, put your hands down there.
It's only 3 minutes.
Yeah, it's a 3-minute song. Yeah, we're cool.
We normally don't fall. We don't break till 26 after.
Yeah. Reanimation's the name of the CD. Out today, by the way. And this one's called Points of Authority. Yeah, yeah. Ooh, the game. Somebody else takes a lot of frame. Move your name to shake. Rock your face. You can't run the race. The pace is too fast. You're just too fast. Fast, 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 fast. Linkin Park, everybody. Mike and Rob are both here from the band tonight, and we're going to take ourselves a little break. Reanimation is the name of the CD. It is out today, and we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back. LoveLine is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
Jeez, 30 minutes into the show, I've not had a Baby Ruth bar yet, Anna.
Ooh, yeah. I did a voiceover thing for Baby Ruth a few weeks back, and they dropped off, say, several
metric ton
Baby Ruth bars. Yeah. And here's the thing about me. I looked at this suitcase of Baby Ruth bars they gave me, and I thought, well, I can't eat all these. And Evidently, I can. But the thing is my new plan is now eat them all as fast as I can because
get it over
let's
with.
Not stretch this out over the course of the year. So, well, Baby Ruth all the way around, by the way. Linkin Park is our guest tonight. And you know what? I ran into today, and I don't know if you guys know this guy, but the guy that's going to be indignant no matter what. It's the guy you bump into by mistake and you go,
oh, yes.
Oh, excuse me. And they go, yeah. And you go, oh, I'm sorry. And they go, I guess you didn't see me. You know, the guy was not going to let.
Those aren't always guys.
Yeah. They're oftentimes women, right? Big gals. Yeah. They're angry. Drew's miming on the radio. That's Marcel Marceau over here. That's great radio. But you know what I had today? It happens in cars a lot. You're pulling out of a driveway. There's a panel truck parked on the street. So you start inching, looking. Oh, here comes a car. You stop. And the guy slows down and drives past you like, what kind of maniac on the loose?
Right.
You know, and you're like, hey, dick, I'm inching out. And then guess what? I saw you, so I stopped. Now you're going around. I didn't T-bone you at 80. I'm just inching out. Well, I was trying to get on the lot where we do the man show, same lot that we did for LoveLine all those years. And I don't know what it is with security guards, but they go home each day after work and somebody shakes their head like it was an Etch-A-Sketch and just clears it of every memory and every visual that ever was in there. And every time you pull in, it's a new day. I've been on the man show. I've been on this lot for 4 years. I got the guys like, huh?
4 years? We've been there since 96.
That's true. Between Six LoveLine years. And the man. Huh? Who are you? What? So I was like, oh, Christ. So here's what I do today. There's a big, long line to get onto the lot. And the first guy's holding everybody up, and I'm running late, and we're doing three shows. So I do my star move where I slide in the exit side, and I slide in the guy's side. I'm like, hey, buddy, just lift the gate. You know me? And he's like, no. Now can do, back of the line. And now just like my life's like really like a bad movie. The line that was waiting is all, everyone's blowing through it now, and I'm arguing with the guy. So the guy's like, no, and I'm like, look, just let me on the other side of the gun. And by the way, it's a piece of 1x3 pine that's between me and freedom. Could you just lift the thing up, and then we'll talk? Nope, don't know who you are, don't know. So I go, all right, F this. I throw it in reverse. I start to move into reverse, but I move about 4 inches, and I see there's a guy standing behind the car, and I hit the brake immediately. I don't hit the guy. I don't even graze the guy. He's just walking behind my car. And then now the look. Now that's the thing. And I give him the hand wave. Hey, sorry there, buddy. And he's like, yeah, you almost hit me. And naturally, he's going to the lot, too. So when I pull into the thing and roll the window down, he's standing there, too. And he's like, yeah, you almost hit me. And I'm like, yeah, sorry about that. And he's like, well, that was close. I was like, yeah, well, I stopped, you know. Well, you almost hit me. And now that we've gone like three laps, now it's like I get pissed and I go, but I didn't hit you, did I? You're fine, aren't you? Now he's indignant. Oh, excuse me, I'm a little bit shaken up. A little bit shaken up. The car was going a quarter of a mile an hour. Did not do a quarter of a rotation.
Describe the guy, just so I can get pissed
Describe
off.
Him, close your eyes and picture a pussy. There's nothing worse than a puss. You know what I mean? Like, I hate a pussy.
What kind of puss?
This is the worst kind of puss. Young white male puss. You know the puss? The guy who's nothing wrong with him. He's not old. He's not fat. He's not scarred. He's not in a wheelchair. He's just a puss. He's acting like a chick. You know? Oh, God forbid someone put a car in reverse on the same planet he's on without giving him a formal written notice.
What was his job on the lot?
I have no idea.
But what would your imagination
I imagine, like, fluff boy.
Okay.
I imagine he just went and gave oral to all the men on the lot and then slinked off it, leaving a trail of bloody semen. That's what I thought this guy did. But, you know, these pusses, like, nothing happened. Listen, everybody, if nothing... By the way, look, if I take a crossbow, fire it off, and narrowly miss your head, and it sticks in a plank right behind you, you get a couple of apologies for that one. But attempting to back up, seeing you, and then stopping, that's just driving, isn't it? It's like, you back up, there he is, you stop, no harm, no foul. This guy said it went like a BJ and $1,000 because you decided to try to back out in your automobile. I just hate a puss guy. You know what I mean? Like, I would rather... Like, when it comes to driving, and I'm behind a guy, you know, once in a while you stop at the signal, the light turns green, and there's that guy speeds out, makes a quick left in front of the traffic. I applaud that guy. Could have killed somebody, but I like the cut of his jib.
Wait, if you know what I mean? Doesn't slow you down.
Doesn't slow me down. I like this cat. Yeah. But I hate a puss, and I hate it especially in a young male. It's the worst kind of puss, is it not? Women, you can forgive. Fat folks, who knows what's going on with them.
The women don't come in that
Orientals
version.
Or Asians, you know, whatever. All the different ethnicities, maybe that puss is part of their culture. It's hard to argue with. But the white 20-something-year-old male puss, that's the toughest. That's the most bitter puss pill to swallow. So all you guys out there went like four apologies for nothing. Kiss my ass, you pussies. You get one, and you like it. I gave him the wave from in the car, and I gave him the sorry when you know the window rolled down. But he was going for a fourth, and that's when trouble reared its ugly
head. How'd you end it?
I just said, look. I did not run you. Now you start arguing. Now you're yelling at the guy who almost ran over. It's very sad. You guys aren't.
How did you end it?
I drove on a lot. That was it.
He was going on a lot. I see.
Oh, very uncomfortable. It was all steamed up. Then I pulled on the lot, and, you know, I got my name on the lot, and there's a car parked in my space, and it had a vanity plate, and it said costume with a K on it. And I just thought, Jesus Christ, I had a bat right now. Just destroy this car. Costume. How dare they? Got the name right on the spot, everybody. All right. I'm a big star, John?
Yep.
You're 20?
Yes, sir.
What's up?
Well, this is kind of aimed towards Dr. Drew, and I also kind of have another question, too.
All right, go.
This one's my main concern.
By the way, a word of advice. If you have more than one question, don't ask us if it's okay if you ask it. Just go zoom right on ahead, because if you ask, Adam will say no. So,
all right.
Go ahead.
I'll remember that.
No.
Okay, well, my girlfriend has herpes.
Yeah.
And when we have, well, we don't have sex when she has an outbreak, okay?
Right.
But sometimes, you know, one thing leads to another, and, you know, start touching each other. And I was wondering, is it possible to get herpes anywhere besides, you know, your penis? Or
Absolutely. It's a skin disease. You can get it.
He's walking in the minefield, isn't he?
Well, it commonly occurs in the finger, sort of gets in around the nail.
That's what I'm talking about.
You got it there?
Well, there's something there that looks like what she gets when she has her outbreak.
And it hurts like hell. It hurt all the way up your arm.
It is kind of painful.
Yeah, it's called herpetic whitlow. And that's herpes.
Is that when you see the guys wearing those little finger condoms? Is that what they have? You ever see those things, Drew?
Yeah, I think that's what they used to use for rectal exams and things.
Oh, Jesus, I ate one of those. Oh, my God. It's disgusting.
So, what can I do about that?
You should, that can be treated. You should look into some Famvir or Zovrax or Valtrex, these medications that are used. Because herpetic whitlow is really quite painful. The finger hurts, the sort of aching all the way up the arm, the lymph nodes swell up under the armpit.
Don't they just use a rubber glove for the anal?
Yeah, long ago, I think they had just these little finger condoms they would use for stuff.
And my second question is, well, this is kind of funny. My brother claims he got a higher score on his MCAT than you, Dr. Drew, and I told him no way.
I can't remember what I got.
Drew was so high when he took his MCAT.
He told me he got a 30, and I don't know if that's good or bad or what.
I can't remember how they score MCAT. Listen, that was, you're talking about
the 20s.
They're asking. I think the MCATs was 24 years ago or something.
Well, Drew did like a whole section on the medical application of leeches. And
bloodletting.
Bloodletting, scarlet fever, the
actually,
plague.
It wasn't even called a physician's test then. It was a barber and surgeon.
Right. I thought the brain was in the abdomen when Drew was doing it back then.
No, actually, I thought the brain was just some sort of filler. It really had no purpose, had no real physiologic function.
Right. They'd not yet done an autopsy.
No, they had, but they still thought it was all in the heart of the chest.
Still thought. And Drew, what is that? What's MCAT stand for? Medical... Oh, boy. Isn't that the first question on the test, Drew?
Medical.
What does this stand for? Where are you?
College aptitude. Medical college admission.
Drew, what did you get? Did you take SATs?
Yeah.
Do you know what those were?
Yeah.
What were those?
What my scores were?
Yeah. Do you remember what
that was?
That was
up around 1,500.
1,500?
Yeah.
Wow. Holy Christ. I had pretty good on those.
But MCAT, I don't think I did so hot on them.
Calling all nerds. Yeah. Mike, Rob, what'd you guys say? You remember, did you take any SATs?
I got a...
I can't remember.
I got a 1250.
1250?
Yeah.
Our guitarist got a 14, like, yeah, I think I'm 10 or 14. Something.
What's perfect in that? 1600?
1600.
Yeah, I think that's what I got.
Yeah, so I assumed. I never even took it. But Drew, the reason you got a high SAT is because your dad, he stood over you for weeks.
Oh,
like,
no, no.
Whip.
No, no, no. I went
you
to a school.
You had to take pre-SATs.
I was to a school. My parents didn't know anything about any of this stuff. It was a school that tracked you into all that.
But what good is that then when they prep you on the test advance?
No, 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 no.
What do you mean
days? Zero.
What did they do?
Zero
what were you going at that school? You mean your school?
Just the education had you.
You didn't go to a special school?
Not for the test. And the tests were just, don't worry about it. You guys will kill on these. Just go do
it. Oh, if you do that?
Yeah.
Wow. Jesus Christ. Drew, what if your kids don't take the SATs? You kill yourself?
Cyanide capsule.
Cyanide? Yeah. Okay, good. Jesus Christ. I didn't even know what they were. I remember they had the PSATs, mm-hmm. like the pre ones.
I didn't know either, but I was told, hey, sit down and take this test.
15 something, though.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just go with it. Go with it. Stephanie?
14? All right. Stephanie?
Yes.
You're 20?
Yes, I am.
What's up?
I have a problem. I don't know if it's a problem. I've had sex 4 times in my whole life mm-hmm. with 4 people, and I always find a reason. I mean, it's always been a one night stand. I always find a reason to, like, repulse myself the next morning. I don't want to have anything to do with them.
What kind of reasons?
Like, I'm not attracted, stupid physical characteristics. I mean, silly stuff. And I won't sleep with anyone that I care about. I've had one good relationship. Like, he would do anything for me in the world. And I just...
You sabotaged that one.
We messed around, and I was like, oh, my God, forget this. And I 2 weeks later, I'm in tears. But, you know, while I'm breaking up with him, it's the smartest thing I've ever done.
All right. You got intimacy issues.
Oh, yeah.
Where's your dad? What'd your dad get on the SATs?
I'm sure he failed. Too many drugs, but...
All right. Well, there you go.
My dad's not bad. I mean, he's not in my life. I mean, a lot.
That's bad for you. And that's bad for your... It's bad for your relationships.
But, you're the doctor, you and there, but, I mean, my parents didn't have, like, an awful relationship. I don't know what else to do. I don't know how.
All right. I'm putting it on hold because of our bad connection. But here's the thing. A lot of people aren't great at a lot of stuff at the beginning of their life. You know, when you're 20, you're not much good at anything. It's hard to be good if you're playing instruments. Hard to be good if you're a carpenter. It's hard to be good if you're a doctor, student, whatever. Relationships. Everything needs work. And the thing about anything in life is you're not damned to be in the place that you began at. I mean, if you're bad in relationships, you can get better in relationships. You know, she knows what her weaknesses are. She can focus on them. And I mean, here's what I'm saying. We don't treat relationships or sort of psychological well-being like we do everything else.
Right.
Like, I mean, I'm a carpenter. I'm now going back to carpentry now that the man shows over and Jimmy's going to ABC, by the way. But I wasn't a good carpenter at 20. I didn't know anything. I was a goomper, you know. I just humped drywall. I didn't really do anything. But I figured I'll just do it every day, and I'll buy a couple of tools, and a few years down the road, I'll be a journeyman carpenter one day. And lo and behold, it all came to pass, and it's the same with Linkin Park. What are you guys, 19 now? Are you 20? Is anyone over 20? Point is there was a point where you sucked, right?
Yeah.
Right, but you said, that's fine. We'll just keep at it. We'll keep going, and we'll keep plugging away, and we'll be better at it, and that day has come. Same with Drew and being a doctor. Same with relationships. Same with life.
Right.
So if you're not good in relationships, you have a little trouble with intimacy, fine. Work on a little better in your next relationship. Understand your tendencies. You got a guy you like, you want to break up with him, don't break up with him. Push. You got to struggle a little bit, right?
Well, not allow yourself to sabotage, to hang in. She pushes relationships away.
I'm just saying relationships aren't any different than any other facet of life.
That's right.
It'd take a little work.
Yep.
All right. Linkin Park's here tonight. We'll take a little break. We'll be right back.
Love Line. 1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
We'll be right back. Hey, everybody. Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Jack Osborne is coming on here on Thursday. Linkin Park here tonight. Rob and Mike both here from the band. And new CD, Reanimation, is out today as we speak. All right. Let's, and we'll hear something else off of that in the 11 o'clock hour. Let's get back to the phones. We'll speak to Jeremy, who's 18. Jeremy?
Jeremy. Yeah?
Yeah.
I'm here.
What's up?
Nothing much. Well, like, I had sex with my girlfriend for the first time. I was a virgin, but she wasn't.
Mm-hmm.
And she, like, I guess she passed gas, you know? Right. I kind of heard it, but I smelt it really bad. But I don't think she knew that I knew, you know?
Right, right.
So, like, every time I'm around her, it's, like, really weird now.
Nope.
No.
Nope, now it's bogus.
Sorry, it's bogus.
It's horrible.
No, it's bogus.
This is a bogus call. It's a horrible call.
You think I'm lying?
Yeah, we do. Now we really think you're lying with your indignant, "You think I'm lying?" Yes, Jeremy. You got to do better than that.
You got to have a question.
Okay, well, you want a real question? Because I'll give you a real question.
All right, no. Go ahead. Well, give him a chance. He came clean. That's
question
good.
Is, why is Adam such an a-hole?
She hates her dad.
She what?
She hates her dad. She, like, so wants to kill him all the time.
Right.
I don't know what to do.
How does she treat you? How does she treat you?
She treats me great. I think she gives, like, all the affection that she's going to give to her dad to me.
Yeah, don't worry.
She'll turn that on you, too, some of that negative feeling. So? Yeah.
Yeah.
Why does she hate her dad so much?
I don't know. I guess, like, he used to, like, yell at her and cuss her all the time. I don't think, maybe he hit her a couple times, but he doesn't anymore, so as far as I know.
Hmm. All right. Don't get her pregnant. You
yeah,
hear me?
Don't get her pregnant.
Yeah. Try not to, because anybody, and this is really, it's something all fathers should tell their sons, but if you want to know how a woman is going to treat you, find out how she feels about her dad. Because if she hates her dad, there's going to be trouble. If her dad abused her, there's going to be trouble. If the dad abandoned her, there's going to be trouble. I mean, thank God for these abusive, abandoning dads, though, because it really keeps all the strip clubs filled, keeps all the porn movies rolling along.
Refuels the porn.
That's right. It's really, I have a love-hate relationship with these abusive dads because it's like, on one hand, I hate them for what they do with their daughters, but on the other hand, I get a lot of beat-off mileage to these young ladies who pay their fathers back by going into pornography. You know what I mean? I guess it's one of those cycles in nature, Drew.
Yeah. Don't we have enough now just to cycle through? You know what I mean? The pornography, that is?
I don't know, but see, they get older, and we need new generation to step in. You see what I'm saying?
You can't be distracted by the style of the time, what you're saying. The hair has to be
current. You mean, I thought about this as I was watching one of these, like, John Holmes movies the other night, and I thought, geez, everyone in this movie's dead. They all died of AIDS 4 years ago. This is horrible.
Nice.
Even John Holmes is dead, you know?
So you don't want to be distracted by any of those sorts of thoughts.
It's weird beating off to a dead guy.
What if they were all dead? Like, we should stop making pornography, and what we had is what we had.
Right.
And that moved forward through history with, that was our...
Do we have to kill all the current porn stars?
No, they'll all eventually die off, and then you'll have your body of work that be worth more money now because a bunch of dead people.
I have to discuss that with my balls and get back to you.
Thank you.
Because I'm not sure. Where are you guys at with that? Does that bother you? What if someone's in a porn movie you know is dead? Can you still enjoy it?
All I know is that this is absolutely the first time that this entire conversation has happened in my life.
Yeah,
and
me too.
I know I'm going to remember that, the day we released Reanimation, we were on Loveline and Adam was talking about dead porn stars and their abusive fathers and all this crap, and it was really heavy, and I haven't sorted it out yet at all.
You want a moment to process?
I think I'm gonna have some weeks to get through that.
I think we traumatized.
It's definitely
apart.
It's good. We're gonna have to have the next time all my friends come over, we're gonna have to have a guy sit down and really get through that one.
It's tough. I can tell you that I have a couple of these John Holmes tribute films, and one of them starts off in the graveyard with the narrator speaking to John Holmes' headstone, which I find in poor taste for pornography. You know what I mean?
Even for pornography.
This guy comes, he's wearing Sansa belt slacks and a bad V-neck sweater, and he's looking at John's headstone. He's like, "Well, John, you brought us a lot of pleasure, buddy. But now I'm like, what? I got to beat off to this? Jesus Christ. Well, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just saying, you use your heads. I want to remember John the way he was. Not staring at his headstone before I have at myself. Petra?
Yeah.
And by the way, it was a bad styrofoam headstone in an indoor studio with really crappy AstroTurf as grass that was sort of bunched up
like
around
indoor,
it.
Indoor-outdoor carpeting.
Horrible. Petra?
Yes.
All right, sorry. You're 17. What's up?
My boyfriend's 18. I'm 17. And whenever we do stuff, he rather just, like, throw me off of him and just say, like, stop it. I don't even want to touch you. And just go to a restroom and jack off.
All right, hold on.
Wow. How old is he?
18.
Jeez. And is he a religious guy?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, you know, Adam is the Weeze always says.
He's religious, and this is not
use
the first
him up
time.
And go?
No, it's sex. It's not like the real
thing. Oh, yeah. It's
and
good, yeah.
You rather prefer oral than anything else?
He does.
Oral, or else him jacking himself off.
Petra.
Yes.
Okay.
Hold on. Clear your jets.
All right.
We got to go to break.
Okay.
All right. Dip that vagina of yours in a bucket of water. A big steam cloud
she's
will come
off.
She's
got momentum.
And just hang on. We got to take a little break, all right? All right. Linkin Park is our guest tonight. We'll be right back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Yeah. Loveline, yo. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Linkin Park in the hizzy tonight. The his house. You know what I'm saying, Drew?
Yeah.
They're
in
the
hizzy. Park. That was them.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, Linkin Park. Rob and Mike are both here.
Or
Rob
not.
And Mike are just, they're signing. Rob's here now. Mike's here now. Signing some stuff for the fans. Keeping it real. That's what I like about these guys. And that's some prima donnas, all coked up, flying in on a Learjet. No, they took donkeys here. True. Not a limo, a donkey. You understand me? That's how real this band is keeping it. Went out, signed some stuff for the kids. There's a whole bunch of kids here tonight. And let me say this, and Drew, I don't say this too often, but we have a few big names on this show from time to time. And if we're lucky, 6 or 8 people show up outside, right, Drew?
Mm-hmm. I opened the show by saying that, did I not? That not only that, this is just the tale of what has followed them from Tower Records. Where were you guys, Tower and Sunset?
Yeah.
Where they just casually decided to turn up, quietly decided they'd show up for the release of their CD, and a huge crowd showed up.
Damn, I'll tell you. Nice. Everyone loves Linkin Park. It's too bad their folks don't like them, Drew.
No, that's fine, but they're in a band. It's all right.
All right.
My parents would be so angry, Adam.
Well, I mean, they like you, but they don't like you like you. That's all I'm saying. All right, let's talk again to Petra, who's 17. Is it Petra or is
Petra.
It Petra?
Petra.
Petra.
She didn't correct you at the opening, though. So
that's true. All right there, Petra. So your boyfriend, 18,
yeah.
Likes the oral sex.
Yeah. He likes oral sex, and he likes to jack himself off, but if I were to touch him or anything, it's like he doesn't like it, but yet he's always fantasizing about other girls touching him and other girls doing vile fantasies with him.
How do you know?
Vile fantasies?
Yeah, he's always talking about, like, these vile fantasies about this other girl, and he's, like, pictures a girl with blonde hair and, you know, just fantasies that he has, but yet...
What happens in the fantasy?
Nothing that they give him oral, and he'll do it with, like, 3 or 4 girls, and it's like...
He has sex with 3 or 4 of them, or they're all just focused on his penis?
I don't know. He's just always saying about his penis this and like.
And he tells you about these fantasies.
He's always telling he acts like if as if he's God's gift. He's always going running just because he thinks he looks fine and he wears nice clothes that I happen to buy all the time. And it's like he thinks he's that. He's all that.
You buy him his clothing.
He's got that part right.
He is a dick.
Yeah.
I buy him all his clothes.
Right.
I paid for his car. I put a body kit on his old car he had. I paid for the paint job. It was a special made paint job. I paid for it.
Do you get all your money? You're 17.
I work. I also go to school. During my vacation, I also work full time.
She must have had the most deadbeat dad of all time.
How much money can you make? I mean, you put in a body kit. What's he got, a Honda or something?
He had a Honda Civic. Now he has a Cadillac CTS because his parents bought it for him. Now he thinks he's everything. He's what girls want.
All right, the guy's a world-class a-hole, but how stupid are you for staying with him?
I don't know. It's like it's hard for me to let go. It's like he treats me bad. I mean, I know that he does, but...
What's not to love?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's
put a body kit on his car.
I pay for it.
By the way, you get a little nod to Adam for having picked Honda as the car he'd own.
Yeah.
I was like, this guy, he's good. He knows what he's talking about.
I see this Joker out on the street all the time. He's got the...
Isn't the guy who was walking behind the car when you tried to pull out?
97 Civic dropped down on the ground. No, this is the other Joker. This is the squatted Honda. It's like it looks like a hovercraft. You can't even really see any light under it. He's got the
Fast and the Furious stuff.
Yeah, that's Fast and the Furious crap. Mm-hmm. Oh, that movie was like Lawrence of Arabia for tards. All the retards saw that movie and was
Dr.
like,
Zhivago.
My God, this is an epic. This is life. This is great. We got guys in Hyundais burning rubber with their front wheels and talk.
And ever since he got into a car accident, he has a new car now, and now his car is a 2003 car, and it's a Cadillac.
Right. All right. Where's your dad?
My dad, I don't live with him. It's,
yeah.
Like, we're not.
But what kind of a deadbeat was he?
Just like kind of was never there for me.
Yeah, but did somebody take care of him too?
Who? My father?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so.
Your mom didn't put a body kit on his Honda or anything?
She didn't. My mom's the word of the house, and she didn't do anything for him. It's more what my mom says goes, and that's it.
All right. Well, look, we don't like this guy. I don't know what he's doing in the bathroom beating off. He's telling you about all his fantasies. He's getting you to buy him clothes.
He's a horrible guy. This is not a relationship.
He's going jogging so people can look at him, you said?
He's all looks. That's all. He's all looks. That's all he wants.
But he's not even that.
He thinks so, and I mean,
yeah, he thinks so.
All right, look.
It's hard.
Why don't you do a little better for yourself? Could you please?
Mm-hmm.
You're not even considering what you need or what you think is attractive or what you're up for, you know, what you could get for yourself that would make you happy.
Mm-hmm.
You got to think in terms of that.
I do, and it's...
All right, that's enough. Do what Drew said. Stop it. And listen, all you screwballs out there, stop sinking 40 grand into $8,000 cars. it doesn't make great sense financially. Now, I'm the first guy who likes to throw some rims on a car. Don't get me wrong. I like that, but these guys are going crazy with these Hondas and stuff. And this Fast and the Furious. You see this movie?
No.
You guys see this movie?
Yeah, I saw it.
Yeah.
It was just on the other night, and that's the one with the ending where he says, I just live life 60 seconds at a time.
Yeah. Yeah.
I couldn't believe it.
I live my life a quarter mile at a time, baby. It's like, oh, wow. That, and by the way, whoever's acting with Vin Diesel when he explains to his bitch that he lives his life a quarter mile at a time, she should get an Academy Award for not laughing.
Yeah.
Forget about her acting. Just not busting up going, hey, are you high? What the hell is this? I live my life a quarter. I don't like anybody who explains how they live their life, especially when it's at a distance. Yeah, when the green flag drops, the BS stops, baby. Quarter mile at a time. And you know what's crazy about those movies is they start putting things in cars that don't really exist, like the guy street racing, and all of a sudden the floorboard blows off on the passenger side. The floorboard flies out like that's ever happened in the history of racing. A unibody car has the floorboard just somehow come detached and fly off. And then there's a thing on the dashboard that's beeping, and it says intake manifold pressure, danger, danger, danger.
That is literally like a Bugs Bunny cartoon with the speedometer going around real fast,
right,
and stopping, saying, incredible, ain't it? And then keep it going, keep spinning.
Intake manifold pressure, danger. Cartoon. It's going to blow. All right. All right. Drew, you put any nitrous on that BMW of yours?
Oh, sure.
Okay. You run a bottle?
Drew lives his life one caller at a time.
That's right. Drew lives life one caller at a time. Baby, I take my, I live my life one nap at a time. Occasionally with the beat off thrown in. But that's my philosophy, baby. And if you want to ride with Ace, you better learn to nap and beat off, too, because that's how it's going to be. Yeah. Jonathan?
Hey, what's going on?
You're 16?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I loved you guys.
Good time.
All right. Every time I'm about to get at all, like, intimate with some girl, I get these horrible panic attacks. Hmm. I don't know what's causing them.
Have you ever had a longer-term relationships?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just...
What's the longest?
7 months.
And even that relationship, you'd still get panic every time?
Yep.
Do you have panic in other situations?
No. Or I'm afraid of, like, water I can't see the bottom of, and I'm afraid of, like, I don't know. It's mostly things I can't see, like being out in the dark and stuff like that.
And what do you mean by panic attack? What happens?
My heart starts racing. I get really scared. I don't know what I'm scared of. I get sweaty. I mean...
Are you able to function? Are you able to forge on?
No, not usually.
You have to stop?
Yeah.
And so what do you say? I'm sorry, I'm having a panic attack?
Well, no.
Well, he explains to her that he lives his life one panic attack at a time. That's what I do.
I'm all about. But, no, it's just like, oh, well, I gotta do something. And the girl that I was with for 7 months, I was like, well, yeah, I get these anxiety fits. And then she's like, oh, okay, I understand. And then, is it me? And I'm like, no.
Why don't you have that treated? Panic attacks can be treated.
I'm taking Zoloft. I don't know if that has...
Oh, is it helping?
No.
Zoloft is not one of the typical, I mean, not the first line for panic. Actually, Paxil is the one we think
I just got off Paxil.
Paxil didn't work?
Mm-mm. They've been switching me on and off and stuff.
All right. And so you can't have sex when you're having the panic attack?
I'm going to try and wait until you get married for that.
Oh, I see. Well, why are you panicking then? You're not doing anything.
I don't know. That's why I'm calling you.
I know, but I mean...
Are you afraid you're
going to... What do you need your penis for? That's what I'm saying.
Is there something you're afraid you're going to find out?
No. I don't know. Like, I've sat and thought about it, and it's just like... I don't know what's going to happen. Am I going to suck at what I'm doing?
Yeah, but what would some of the more scary feelings be if you just kind of went on and became intimate with someone? What if you didn't like it?
Yeah, that might be part of it.
Are you religious?
Not really.
Well, if you didn't like it, what would that make you think?
Gay.
That I was gay. Yeah, we don't want that.
Oh, that made you gay.
Oh,
now you're gay.
It.
Sorry, Jonathan. Now you're going to have to live your life one dork at a time.
I'll tell everybody that it was on the LoveLine show.
Yeah, well...
I realized I was gay.
All right. Well, I don't understand why you don't want to have sex until you're married, but you're not religious.
It's just a personal thing. Like, it gets me more chicks.
It what?
Huh?
It what?
Gets him more chicks, he says. Gay? Drew, how do you know gay? You hear gay?
I know gay. Oh, anyways, I'm
Drew knows gay. Drew bought
Drew
bought a couple of, what'd you do, buy a condo that was owned by a gay couple?
Oh, yeah. I owned two pieces of property that were.
You know how he knew there was a, it was, well one of the land had AIDS? Is that what happened? How did you know?
No, they were quite clear about what their preferences were. And
Drew knew with the condo when he opened the front door and a tidal wave of semen knocked him over and washed him down the street.
I still wasn't convinced.
Like in The Shining.
Yeah.
But,
it was like those twins in The Shining. But when the elevator opened and semen just carried him down the hall.
However, when I found the squeegee in the shower, I knew.
Yeah.
I knew what
the
was
gays happening. Squeegee, you know, the gays, they don't use shower curtains. They use those Lucite doors because they like to rub their ass against it while their partners. I mean, I'm just hypothesizing, but what else could it be for? And then after each shower, they squeegee it off. You see, they keep it clean like a windshield, whereas I urinate on my shower door to clean it. That's what I look at. I drink a gallon of Windex, and then I whiz all over the shower door. But you found squeegees in both those.
Squeegees.
Yeah.
But Jonathan's having a panic about something. And it's interesting how he's sort of avoidant of the whole thing. He doesn't want to get married, doesn't want to get intimate. It's really super, super avoidant. And I suspect that he's just afraid of how he's going to feel when he gets there. And it's going to be something surprising to him. I don't know if it's that he's gay necessarily, but that would certainly be one reason. If he gets there, he finds out he has no arousal, not interested. Ooh, I'm horrified. What does that mean? Must mean I'm not
married. That would suck if he's already married.
Yeah, it would suck. And that's why he's got to really kind of get a little more honest with himself and explore a little more his relationships.
He did protest a little bit. Jonathan?
Yeah.
No thoughts of young lads?
No, not really.
All right.
No. But
not really?
Not
really?
I was thinking while I was on hold, there is, like, serious arousal. It's not like, I can't get it up while I'm with a girl, and I'm like, oh, what's going on? Maybe it's like I'm afraid I'm going to get too carried away and I'm going to break my vow to myself.
But what's that vow all about?
Yeah, why would you make the vow to yourself?
I don't know, watching too much TV and people getting AIDS and babies and stuff like that.
Here's what I would suggest. I would suggest that the vow you make to yourself is something to keep you away from getting intimate with a woman, because then you say, oh, I don't want to break this vow that I've made, this imaginary vow, you're 16-year-old, you're not religious, yet you've made this vow, and so you have to stop short all the time. I think you've created that to sort of stop yourself.
Or not. Maybe it's just the biology of panic, and these are highly evocative situations, and he just spirals out of control. Maybe, one of the last question, any abuse history with him? Just to kind of...
Jonathan?
Any sexual abuse or trauma or anything?
Not that I remember, no.
Nothing like that. All right.
Good times,
everybody. Just try to calm down. You know, deep breathing, slow, easy breathing. Move on in these relationships. Just get more intimate. Now, I'm not saying have sex necessarily. That's not what's in your values. But feel what it feels like to be intimate with someone and see how you feel.
Yeah, it's gooey. Amanda?
Yes?
You're 27?
Yes.
Feel uncomfortable when your boyfriend touches your vagina?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Every time we have foreplay, mm-hmm. there's sometimes that I can't have him touch me there, and I have to move his hand away, and I feel it's because of my past.
Uh-huh.
And what I'm happens? Trying to figure out how to overcome that.
Well, tell us what the past was.
My stepfather molested me for 13 years.
Did you have some treatment for that?
Yes, I did.
And how long were you in treatment for?
6 years.
All right. And how does that all stand now?
I know that it's not my fault. He's a sick man, mm-hmm. and I've tried to...
You know that intellectually, but emotionally, are you able to have sort of intimate moments and tolerate emotional stress in a relationship and not sort of dissociate? And
I try not to associate anything. There's just certain ways that he'll touch me when we're having foreplay. I don't know. It just makes me think about...
Yeah. 13 years, huh?
Yeah.
How old were you when it started?
5.
Wow.
Why don't you describe to him specifically, precisely what those ways are so he can avoid it?
We've tried that, and he's tried to avoid it. He's just like, he tells me that's like one of the ways that he likes to pleasure me, and I tell him that...
All right, then he's an idiot.
It's not... It's
he's got to understand that you have a very, very... profound trauma that's etched into your physiology, and it's triggered by these behaviors, and he's got to stop initiating this. That's it. Things could go. It's great that you can have intimacy. It's no wonder you have certain sorts of awful feelings triggered by aspects of physical intimacy. If you can avoid those aspects, you may have a perfectly satisfying relationship.
Okay.
Hey, you don't have to tell me twice to stay away from a woman's vagina, by the way. I'd live my whole life with you just getting BJs. And maybe a little reverse cowgirl or something like that. But I don't have to monkey with that part.
Reverse cowgirl?
Yeah, she gets on top and faces the TV.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Reverse cowgirl, okay.
Yeah, that's...
You have to be near a vagina to do that one, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, but she doesn't like him touching.
Oh, I see.
No, it's just certain...
How about being in? How about... How about...
Touch me?
I know, but how about the sex?
The sex is wonderful.
You see what I'm saying? And what about oral sex?
Oral sex is wonderful, too.
So did your... stepdad touch you and that was it, or
no,
he had sex with you?
Yes.
And yet that's okay?
Yes.
It's great. Listen, that's great.
I know
it
is.
That intact.
It is. And what about your mom? How about you give her a nice swift kick in the labia for bringing this a-hole home?
Actually, she gave him a swift kick out the door after she found out.
Yeah, after 13 years.
He also threatened me to kill my mom, and I was very young, so...
Yeah, but the point is, your mom let this go on for 13 years.
Your mom's not exactly, like, ex-Scotland Yard.
No.
I'm guessing you guys weren't living in a palace, right?
No.
You live in a small place?
Actually, no, we lived in a nice house.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, that's all right, then. All right, so, Amanda, You're telling me that this guy keeps touching you in this particular way that you're telling him not to touch you in, but the sex is fine, the oral sex is fine. He just has to continuously touch you in a way that reminds you of your stepfather molesting you?
Not continuously, it's just...
Repeatedly, though. Repeatedly.
You know, he's understanding more and more every day. You know, we've only been together for 5 years, and it's...
Five years?
Open up to him more and
but
more.
But it's 5 years, man, and he's insisting on repeating this one thing that you find awful.
What is it, by the way? What's the technique?
The middle finger is just, like, into the clitoris and then goes into the vagina like my stepfather did.
And he just...
And I'll wipe him away. He you wants... know, I'll, like, swat his hand away, and he, you know, he's like, why did you do that? And I'm like, I don't want to say anything because we're right in the middle of it, and I don't want to ruin it and, you know, crush his ego.
Yeah.
Go ahead and crush his ego, man.
You don't want to offend his F finger. They're very sensitive, those F fingers, that middle finger. I remember once when a chick, you know, she brushed my F finger off, and we didn't speak for years. Amanda,
mm-hmm.
I don't know about this guy now. He can't avoid the one, you know, this bowling ball move with you.
It's really hard, but that's like one of his most favorite things to do.
How would it be his most favorite
thing? That's bizarre. It's not his favorite thing. He must enjoy seeing you in pain.
I'm outraged at this individual.
He must enjoy seeing her in misery.
Hold on. The whole fingering thing, by the way, falls off the list of favorite things to do about the 10th grade. Do you know what I mean? I mean, as soon as the BJ rolls around and the doggy style rolls around and the thumb in the... Oh. I mean, for some weirdos, they like a finger in their ass. As soon as that rolls around, the fingering thing is almost... That's almost like a chore. It's like... it's a compulsory part of sex. You know what I mean? It's like, all right, you've had the finger, I've given the finger, but let's get the finger over with so I can get... Let's make a little room for the penis. That's all. That's all we're doing here. I could gladly pull that one off my sexual list in seconds, right? And yet he keeps going back with the same move, and she keeps telling him, and he's like, oh, my feelings are hurt. This is my move.
No way.
Weird.
No
there.
Way.
Something's weird, and she should have... I now don't trust this guy. What's this guy do for a living?
He's a mechanic.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And he's probably got a bunch of grease on that cuticle that he puts up in you, right?
No, I make him take a shower before we go to bed.
All right. This sounds like he's a little angry.
Or he needs her just to be a victim. He needs to see that victim come out in her.
But maybe his thing, too,
you see what
is...
I mean?
Yeah, but here's another theory, and that's probably right, too. But maybe this guy's like, oh, I got this chick. She got worked over by her stepdad, and now I got to pay. Now I got to pay. So instead of being compassionate about the whole thing, I'm being sort of combative about it. You know, sometimes people...
Yeah, but that's a victimizer impulse.
But he's not trying to do that. He's very compassionate and very loving towards
then
me.
Then tell him
and
to stop.
Tell him to stop, he will. It's just, I don't think he understands what that really does to me.
Then,
okay, just explain to him.
I have, and I don't think he really gets it. He's never had anything, you know...
Doesn't get the raped by stepdad for 13 years part that
yeah he does get that. It's just certain thing, you know, that just that certain
all right,
thing
just,
sexually, that's it. He doesn't get it.
She doesn't, she's not even here.
I don't know. She's, all right, Amanda, do you have kids?
Yes.
All right, no more kids.
I can't have no more kids. We both decided no more.
Good. How many do you have?
Two.
All right, but don't screw those kids up. All right,
I'm not trying to.
Okay,
I'm really not.
All right. Kids would be, you know, those kids would have a better life. I put them in one of those balloon launchers that was made out of surgical tubing and just shot it at a frat house.
Yeah.
Better life. Wait a minute. I'd have a better life if someone did that to me, too. Oh, Jesus Christ. You know there's a mess over there, by the way. This screwball, Mr. Goodwrench, shoving his fingers up her all the time. My God. I would be so done. I'm so done with that maneuver in my life. You guys are young. You got a lot of fingering ahead of you, but not me. Not Pops Corolla. His fingers are done. True. Smell my hand.
No.
Nothing. Nothing. Smells like pine.
Smells
nothing.
Like beer.
There. Okay. Beer. Pine. Whatever. The point is, doesn't smell like I've working a cannery in Alaska.
No.
Does it? No.
No.
There's nothing there, and that's my business hand too. You guys want to snap for your cool?
No, that's
cool?
All right.
Okay. Gonna take a little break. Linkin Park is here. And we're going to hear something off the new Linkin Park CD, Reanimation, when we come back.
Hello, this is your radio. Radio. Loveline will be right back.
Loveline is brought to you by Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
Hey everybody, it's Loveline. I'm Adam, that's Drew. Yeah, that's right. Living our life, man. One call at a time. Linkin Park's in here, man. Oh man, 100% pure adrenaline going in here, brother. I'll tell you, man, if it gets too hot, man, we just gotta open the door, man. There's a lot of heat going on in this place, man. Oh man. You know what we're going to do, man? We're going to helicopter. We're going to drop us off on a mount, man. We're going snowboard, man, with parachutes, man. You know what I mean? Free fall after we go off the cliff. And I'm just tired of everyone living their life. Stay home, everybody. Stay home. Turn that TV on, would you? Stop with all the extreme sports. And by the way, you know, if you just came into this country and you turned on the TV and you saw all this sort of extreme stuff that was going on constantly, wouldn't you just assume every American was just constantly luge racing on a skateboard or snowboarding or something or barefoot water skiing? There's like 20 guys in the whole country that are effing it up for the rest of us. That's the way I look at it. And there's 1,000 Mountain Dew commercials made about it and 100 movies made about it. I've had enough. Just everyone knock off the extreme sports. I don't want to know about your lifestyle. Take all the racks off your car and just go home and wait to die. That's what we should be doing.
Good time.
Yeah? I live my life one porn flick at a time, Drew. I'll tell you that.
Really? For you, that's something.
Pretty good. All right. Linkin Park here. We're going to take a call.
Then listen to a song.
That's right.
All right.
Natalie?
Yeah. Wow, Linkin Park, you guys are awesome. I was at Tower Records today. I just thought that was so great how you came out for your fans like that.
Thanks, Natalie. Thanks for coming out.
I had two quick questions. One was I wanted to know what inspires you guys to write your music.
Oh. Well, the musical part is kind of it's a lot of experimenting and a lot of just like mixing different things. You know, whatever we can kind of come up with screwing around at like 5 in the morning in our studio. To make things sound, you know, just a little bit different. And as far as the lyrics, it's pretty much just everyday stuff. You know, we're not trying to make up stories and out of thin air. We're just trying to, you know, talk about what's going on.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
I also wanted to know what your favorite thing about touring was.
Oh, favorite thing. What's your favorite? Besides the shows?
Probably catering.
Free food, right?
Yeah, free food.
I think the food and the shows.
No, actually, I think the show is the best thing. And that, sometimes that's the only good thing about touring.
Do you guys tell the caterer what you want? We got the same stuff showing up each time?
It's really, you know what's funny is they've got, there's a really expensive catering and there's really inexpensive, well, there's relatively inexpensive catering.
Right.
The expensive stuff, you get one catering company that follows you around the entire time and you have to pay for their room and board, you have to pay for their crew, you have to pay for everything about it. If you get just, you know, whichever caterer happens to be in the area at every venue, you have absolutely no idea or control over what you're eating that day. So you show up in, we literally showed up at a show on the East Coast or like in the Midwest, maybe.
Midwest, probably. Food's always worse there.
I wasn't going to say it, but maybe.
Yeah.
The chicken was pink. It was it was pink chicken.
Yeah, and they tried to convince us that it was okay.
They convinced 3/4 of the people working on the tour that it was supposed to be that way.
Oh.
And they all ate it.
When did anything happen? Did they cramp pink?
Hey, you know, people get sick all the time. I don't know. Touring is hard on the body. People get sick. But, I, you know, that's just an example. The catering can be bad.
But do you guys have any specific requests? I mean, you know, you only want green M&Ms.
Oh, you can you can put stuff on the, there's a rider for your dressing room.
Right.
You can put stuff on that. We put, like, socks and underwear on that. That's one crazy, like, weird thing, you know?
Nothing good, nothing, like, rock and roll. Crazy guys ever trash a dressing room because there was too much pimento in your pimento loaf or something like that?
I think our crew would laugh at us if we asked them for green M&Ms or something like that.
They'd be like, come on, you guys. Don't play that role. Give me a break.
You see that, Natalie? This band is keeping it real. Do you hear that?
Oh, yeah. They were great at Tower. You guys are great.
Thank you, Natalie.
All right, Natalie. We're going to hear a song from Linkin Park. Is that all right with you?
Awesome.
All right.
Thanks.
Which one do you want to hear? Do you have one? You have one in mind?
Oh wow!
Say pushing me away.
Something off the new album.
Say pushing me away.
Oh god!
Pushing me away.
Pushing me away.
There you go. All right.
All right. Cue that up, Anderson. You good? All right. Linkin Park, Pushing Me Away.
Thank you.
he's a Jay Ward fan. Linkin Park. Reanimation is the name of the CD, everybody. Rob Miker in here in the studio. And, all right. Very, if you haven't gotten the CD yet and it is out today, go out and get it. We're just talking to the boys about the animation and the art on there. And Mike did it all, and it's extremely impressive. So just go to the CD, go to the video store, the CD store, and go find the coolest looking CD jacket out there. And that'll be your Linkin Park. It's just really, really impressive. Really, I'm impressed, not by so much by the skill of artists, but by the patience. Mm. I start drawing half a circle, I get bored, I gotta quit. I can't hang with it. I'm amazed at the patience, and obviously the skill too, but the sort of patience that artists have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have a friend. I mean, this stuff actually, one of the reasons I like to work on computers, it's pretty fast.
Mm-hmm.
I have a friend who paints, just paint. And he was like sitting in his studio in his house for 3 months doing a show for like, he had to do like 10 paintings. Like 3 months.
Couldn't imagine. And forget about, some of these masters and stuff, the stuff takes 6 months. What's that guy's name that painted the roof of that church, Drew? That guy? Leonardo DiCaprio? What's that kid's name? Crazy. Took him like 4 months?
At least. Lying on his back?
Lying on his back? Jesus Christ. That's a ballsy kid right there, that DiCaprio. Denise?
Yes?
He lives his life one easel at a time.
What?
What's up, Denise?
What are you doing?
We're just talking to you, baby.
Hi, how are you? Hi, Mike, Rob.
Hi.
Hello.
I just want to say I'm an LPU, and
awesome.
Everybody says hi. I'm in the chat room right now.
Oh, cool. Tell them we said what's up.
I will.
These are chat kids.
Huh?
calling LoveLine and chatting at LPU at the same time.
Yeah, exactly. They're all listening right now.
What's your question?
Okay, my question, well, actually, my problem is that I could only orgasm through oral sex.
That's most women your age.
I know, but then the problem is that for some reason he always does that first, and afterwards I just don't want to have sex at all.
Well, that's kind of normal, right? You're kind of done after you've climaxed.
Yeah, well, just tell him to...
Not do that.
Yeah.
Wait.
He does it anyway, I mean...
Tell him to wait till after.
It gets painful because my problem is I get wet really fast and then dry.
I know.
He has to go first. He has to understand that's the way you work. Why can't people do that?
They just can't have...
I don't know why he doesn't listen. It's not like I don't express it.
You're telling him, no, don't do the oral first.
Yes.
Do the intercourse first.
This is, again, for Adam, not a problem, right? Somebody says, hey, Adam, no, just take it easy.
Yeah. Well, here's the way it works for me. They go, don't do the oral sex first, do the intercourse first. And I go, oh, yeah, no problem, honey. And then it's like, oh, man, I'm running late for work. I got to roll. Drew's going to get pissed.
Yeah, but then I still have a problem with getting dry. I mean, I don't know what to do about that.
Why don't you use a little lubricant?
I did once, but I don't know. I didn't like it.
Why not?
I don't know. I didn't like it.
Well, try something else you do. Like, there's no way you should even be able to tell that you're using a lubricant.
How could you tell? You don't need the lubricant because you can have intercourse with a guy, and then he can mop you up with his tongue when he's done, right?
Yeah.
I just tell him to do that.
Why is this so confusing for Denise? I don't understand.
Well, Denise is stupid. And when you're stupid, the world is so confusing, Drew. Everything. Mm-hmm. Everything's every car you get into, you turn the wipers on first. Everything's difficult when you're stupid. Just all you girls, start telling the guy. And listen, this is not satisfactory, this part where you go, I told the guy not to do this, but he still does it. Well, now it's your job to sort of lay down the law.
Mm-hmm.
You cut the guy off sexually.
Oh.
He'll be all ears.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Women are in control. They just, I don't know why they can't realize that.
And I wonder, too, how clearly they express it. Because I think sometimes they're thinking it or they're hinting at it or that's what they're meaning. But they don't come out and tell the guy straight out, here's the way it has to be. They just think it should be obvious. They think he should pick up on the subtle hints. They think he should know, and they get angry at him for not. But meanwhile, they're saying to us, hey, I told the guy, but they didn't really sit him down and tell him. And guys are sort of stupid that way.
Completely.
You have to just, they're like dogs. You got to yank that chain. You got to hit him with a newspaper. of sodomy, whatever people normally do with dogs, that's what you have to do with a guy. Right?
Right.
All right. Linkin Park, our guest and I will take a quick break. We'll be right back.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline. 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 Loveline.
Hey, everybody. Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Linkin Park is in our studio tonight. And Reanimation is the name of the CD. Jack Osborne going to be in here on Thursday night. Be interested in talking to a young Jack. A little bugger. He's like 16 years old. He's going to clubs, signing bands.
Does he go to school?
I don't know. Barely.
What's that band he signed?
Oh, Delusion.
Delusion?
Yeah.
That's an awesome name, though, but I hear they're all right.
They're good
they're
band.
Good. Check them out.
Oh, the guy's going to be... Oh, he's going to OD on coke before he's like 18. What, Drew, when you were 16, what were you doing? I was trying to get a moped when I was 16 years old, going clubbing and signing bands. Oh. Jesus Christ. Well, my dad wasn't exactly the Oz man.
Hello?
Lisa.
Unless you want to call the Oz man, a guy wore like a brown corduroy jacket with suede patches on the sleeves and
nice.
Sansibel slacks yanked up to about his chest.
I thought about the time you were 16, he had the sort of lace-up pants going, didn't he?
No, my dad hit these sort of... All right, now you get me going. My dad and my mom divorced at a very bad time, which was like 19... From a fashion standpoint... They divorced probably about 1975, and my dad, who'd been dressing like a Fred McMurray from My Three Sons with the brown suits and the, you know, wingtip shoes and stuff, all of a sudden decided he had to hip up his look now because he was a single guy out on the prowl. So he got himself a pick, and he grew his hair out, and he had an afro. He got himself some clear glasses. You know what clear glasses look like on a guy?
Oh, my God.
He grew the beard. He looked like one of the guys from, ever see the old Boston record album? He looked like the sixth member of Boston. He got himself some flares that laced up in the front and the back and some platform shoes and an Afghan shirt. I mean, he like tried to turn himself into a swinger in about 3 weeks, and it was a disaster. It was like all of a sudden... It was really like some sitcom dad from the 50s went to work one day, and all of a sudden, like some swinging uncle came back. Remember Courtship Eddie's Father, Drew?
Sure.
Remember that show? Remember the swinging uncle guy?
Yeah.
So yeah, that's who came back to my house.
Was he working at like a job? You know.
Yeah, he had a regular job, where like a school teacher.
Because it seems to me like people who do that, if you've got, it's even more conspicuous when you see the same people every day. Like those
right.
people are just. Going behind your back and going, Whoa, dude, this guy's got some things
like,
going on.
Oh, what happened to Corolla? Jesus Christ, he's a mess. Somebody, please, would you screw him already before he buys another Afghan shirt? Or some more clear glasses? What happens with clear glasses, by the way, if you leave them somewhere? No big deal, right? It's not like you can't drive or anything, right? Clear glasses. Oh, what a disaster.
You mean
no wonder I'm in therapy.
You mean glasses with no lenses?
No, I'm talking about just glasses that had not sunglasses. And there were glasses, but they had no, they were just clear, you know, they had no prescription to them.
Just there's plastic pretend glasses.
Just glasses that look like you're wearing glasses. The kind of glasses, like kind of glasses, you know, like when porn chicks do the librarian thing every once in a while. That was the glasses my dad wore.
Good times.
What a disaster.
Lisa.
Yes?
What's
Thank
up?
God he goes to bed at 7 o'clock at night and he can't hear the show. What's up, Lisa?
I have a question. I want to know if there's any harm in swallowing semen like 3 times a week.
The same persons?
Excuse me?
Same persons?
Same person, yeah.
Nice.
Provided he doesn't have any infectious diseases, there's no problem with it. What prompts the question, pray tell?
No, I mean, this is
just think about it one day.
The first time I've ever done this, and that I do it so often just kind of worried me. So I
Is this something that he's into?
Yeah.
And you're not that into it?
I really didn't think, the first time I kind of really didn't enjoy it. But now I do, and I know that he really likes it, so I just kind of wanted to make sure that everything was okay.
Do you need to swallow it, though? Can't you just transport it into the bathroom?
I do that sometimes, but I know he likes it when I swallow.
Really? Mm-hmm. Likes you to swallow? Yeah. But, I mean, does he like you to swallow it, or does he like you just not to stop when he's having an orgasm?
He prefers that I swallow.
Oh. Man, I don't know if I trust that guy completely.
It's a little bit of an aggressive move.
I mean, he's not, don't get me wrong, he doesn't get upset, but
right.
It turns him on and he really likes it.
Right.
And I'm willing, I mean, I like him that much, so I'm willing to do it.
Hmm. I'm all right with it. But see, I sort of see women, I love women, and I look at them more as semen mules, that they need to transport my semen into the toilet for me. Yeah. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, they're doing that function, that service.
Yeah, they're carrying it from the bedroom into the toilet. But I don't need them to ingest it. I just need them to mule it into the bathroom so I don't have to deal with it.
Okay.
All right, baby?
All right.
That's me. I'm a romantic. I'm old-fashioned.
Thank you.
I like a semen mule. You know, as my father and my grandfather were both that way. My father married a semen mule, and he you know, it was his wishes that I marry a semen mule as well. It's tradition. It's old-fashioned. I know it's a little bit corny, but that's just the way the Corollas are. I think that's why my dad wore those fake glasses. He wouldn't get any semen in his eye.
So they're really sort of protective lenses.
Yeah, because once in a while when you're muling over the semen to the bathroom, you trip and fall.
It's an accident.
You land on your abdomen, the semen comes flying out. It goes right in the cornea.
The semen spills. Yes, sure.
Yeah, you got to mop up. You got to come in and throw down a bunch of kitty litter. So
wildlife
gets
damaged in the
the wild. The baby seals covered with semen.
Seagulls,
seagulls. You got to get a bunch of Greenpeace volunteers to come out and clean everything up. It's a disaster. It's really a disaster. All right, we'll take a little break. I'm going to mule some of my own urine, actually.
Nice.
Into the bathroom. What do you say, Drew?
Good time.
You with me?
Yeah.
All right, Linkin Park's here. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
There's the show, everybody. Off to a shaky start. I was a little bit late. I had a couple of beers in me.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah. But I mellowed out. We got the ship back on track, right? Yeah. I want to thank Rob and Mike coming in here from Linkin Park.
Thanks for having us.
Always good to see you guys. And Reanimation's the name of the CD. It is out today. Go out and get it. Go out and support our friends Linkin Park. And whenever you want, whenever you got time, please come on back. Always welcome. So until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
I'm in my 30s. I live in an urban center, and I'm having sex.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.